guests here today. I'd like to announce, they can just wave their hand, Commissioner Doug Howard. Commissioner Robin Frazier. Commissioner Richard Rockchild. The Mayor of Westminster, Kevin Hucks. I saw Kevin back there. The Mayor of New Windsor, Neil Rogan. Yeah, Chief Spalding here, Westminster Police Chief. We have the President of the Westminster City Council, or Common Council, Dr. Robert Wack. So. And we have our partners from DBED. We couldn't operate our department without our partners from DBED. We have Patrick Barnes here and David Carroll. The person I see every day, most of the day, is my partner in the economic development, and it is John Wheaton. John? Now the really important people here. The Carroll County Public Schools Academy of Finance students are here again this year. We'd like the Academy to please stand. Future of our finance industry is right there. The program offers students of financial service program the opportunity to earn the NAF endorsement as an academic of finance graduate. And a special thanks, I just found this out today, that Mike Shank of M&T Bank personally sponsors all the academic students in attendance today. Mike, we wave your hand. Before we bring Audubon aboard here, I'd like to give you some quick facts on how we're doing. How is Carroll County doing? Last year, our assessable base rose $18 million. As of last month, our assessable base is a little over $30 million. It's almost double, but it should be around $35 million, so it's going to be double. John Wheatman, my partner here, and Amy Wallace have met with over 250 entrepreneurs this year. And if you need money, see John. John has the loan fund. John, raise your hand again so everybody can see John. If you need money, see John. Canoe Break. Most of you have seen the Canoe Break building down on Route 97. 240,000 square feet, a $28 million building. And Land, Sea, and Air purchased the Canoe Break building on 140. So that building is not empty. A great deal for us. We have a lot of prospects looking at us, and especially we have prospects looking at the two Murata buildings. And they're working with Walter Patton at KONB. I don't know if Walter's here. If you need space, see Walter. But we have prospects looking at both buildings now. The Carrolltown Mall, it's going to be demolished, and it's going to be a $50 million redevelopment project. And Doug, thank you for all your help on doing that. Right now, six of our largest industries, our resident industries, are expanding. Our six largest, they're expanding now, our resident industries. In the last 6 months, our prospect list has increased. We have about 24 active prospects. These are not suspects, these are prospects which we already looked at their financing. And also, DBED has been a true partner in giving us most of these prospects, along with site locators, which are really important for our business. Tourism, our second largest industry. The cows are our first, the tourism is the second. They have a new webpage, new website. So those of you go out and look at the new website. We also have a new program, it's been around for about a year, called Celebrate America. It was a commissioner initiative. It's a foster appreciation of the history of Carroll County, and looking at our historical sites. It's a big, big program. New one this year, and Brian, thank you for doing this. It happens to be Brian's birthday today. We made him come in on his birthday. Happy birthday, Brian. If you look on the back of the program, there's a QR code. You can scan it with your phone. Now, not the people in the front. If you can't see it, then you can't scan your phone and play Pac-Man in the front here. It will take you to your PFD document so you can follow along with the presentation. You can use this if you have trouble seeing the screen. Only if you have trouble seeing the screen. What's new, it's on the back of your program here. We couldn't do the program or anything in our department without sponsors. We'd like to thank our major sponsor, our only sponsor, is BB&T. And Chris, would you like to come forward and introduce Audubon and say a few words? Thank you.
Morning, everybody. Thanks for allowing us to have the opportunity to do the sponsorship this morning. And welcome Dr. Basu to talk to us. It's really humbling to stand out in front of the business community and see all the strong businesses and partnerships that are out there. And as part of all this partnership, it is our pleasure to be the sponsor this morning for the breakfast. Since I know you all don't want to hear me talk, I will be jumping into Dr. Basu's intro so you can hear his presentation. Dr. Basu is the chairman and CEO of the Sage Policy Group, an economic and policy consulting firm in Baltimore, and one of the Mid-Atlantic's most recognizable economists. On behalf of the government agencies and nonprofit organizations, Dr. Basu has written several high-profile economic development strategies. In recent years, he's focused upon health economics, the economics of education, and economic development. And he currently lectures at Johns Hopkins in micro, macro, international, and urban economics. In 2007, he was selected by the Daily Record newspaper as one of Maryland's most 50 influential people, and the BBJ named him one of the region's 20 most powerful business leaders in 2010. He's involved with numerous organizations in a voluntary capacity, including serving as the Baltimore City Public School System as a board member and a board member to the Baltimore Children's Museum. He's also on the board of First Mariner Bank and the chairman of the Baltimore County Economic Advisory Committee and advisor to the Baltimore-Washington Corridor Chamber of Commerce. Dr. Basu earned his BS in Foreign Service at Georgetown. He earned his master's in public policy from Harvard and his master's in economics from Maryland, and his JD was earned at the University of Maryland Law School in 2003. Without further ado, Dr. Basu.
Thank you. Good morning again. Good to see the Academy of Finance here again. Faces of change, but the name of the institution remains, and thank you for sponsoring them. That was very kind of you, wonderful of you. My name is Audubon Basu. I'm an economist. Please hold your applause, and I've been asked to talk to you about the economy again. We've done this now for a number of years. Happy birthday, Brian, and thank you, BB&T, for your sponsorship. Most excellent thing. Most excellent people. I've entitled this year's presentation, Going Up for the Rebound. If I move away from the microphone, can you still hear me in the back? Can you still hear me? So Going Up for the Rebound, it's a sports-themed presentation. I'm from Baltimore, so sports have been on my mind a lot lately. Even though it's sports-themed, make no mistake, it's about the economy. I'll start very broadly in my discussion this morning with a primer on the global economy. I'll then quickly taper down into national-level economic data. I'll then provide you regional economic data, including for the Baltimore metropolitan area, the Washington metropolitan area, and of course for Carroll County. I'll then conclude with a forecast for the balance of 2013 and into 2014. I'll talk about financial markets, energy markets, labor markets, consumer markets, all manner of markets as we go through this morning's presentation. And then between 10 and 10:15, if I'm not mistaken, we have time for a question and answer session. So that will be the agenda for the next hour plus. So as I say, I've entitled it Going Up for the Rebound. It's a sports-themed presentation, and my first pitch to you is that things, in fact, are getting better. They are getting better. And you can see that from this audience, by the way. And I'm going to make some points about Carroll County that differentiate this county from the balance of the state in very positive ways. So that will come later in the presentation. But first, let me begin with that primer on the global economy. And in fact, you can see the improvement through global economic data. Here I'm showing you data from the International Monetary Fund. This is real economic growth. In a typical year, the global economy expands 3.6% in real terms, meaning inflation-adjusted terms. Now, 2004 through 2012 on this chart are historic data. 2013 and 2014 are forecasts. The standing forecast for 2013 for the global economy is 3.3%. And the standing forecast for 2014 is 4.0%. Now, true enough, 3.3% is not fabulous, and that forecast has been downgraded since the beginning of the year. Entering the year, the forecast for the global economy had been 3.5%, and actually as late as a year ago, the forecast for the current period had been closer to 3.9%. It's now been downgraded steadily over time, down to 3.3%. So I'm not suggesting to you that the global economy is on a tear. It's not. What I am suggesting to you is that this is the fourth year of global economic recovery. Next year, one presumes, will be a fifth. Now, just because the global forecast is 3.3% doesn't mean that everyone is expected to grow 3.3% this year. Here I'm showing you some granular data regarding economic prospects for 2013. And for purposes of this slide, I know for some of you it might be difficult to see, so let me walk through this. For 2013, for the purpose of this slide, you can basically divide these nations into two major groups. The first group is reflected here by this first blue colored bar, the advanced economies of the world. There are 34 of them. These are the world's most affluent or developed economies, of which the United States, of course, is one. And for purposes of this slide, this group stretches from the advanced economies down through the United States. So these are the advanced economies of the world. You can see that in the aggregate, these economies are expected to grow this year 1.2%, not fabulous. I think you'd agree 1.2% is quite mediocre, in fact, worse than mediocre. And you can see where much of the weakness is, it's in Europe. The euro area is actually expected to shrink this year economically. The French are expected to shrink this year economically. The Germans will grow less than 1%. The Italians and the Spanish will shrink for a third or fourth consecutive year. Now, you can see the forecast for America, or maybe you can't, but the forecast for America is 1.9%. And usually 1.9% is not that impressive. And again, this is the International Monetary Fund's forecast. But if you look at us versus the balance of the advanced world, we look actually pretty good. In some sense, we're the least worst. We are the tallest dwarf, the best house in a bad neighborhood. And so 1.9% is nothing to write home about, but we are, in some ways, the envy of the advanced world, but more on this later. The rest of the world are the so-called emerging developing countries of the world. This is where the bulk of humanity resides, and it's where the fastest growth generally takes place. Now, even here, though, you can see signs of relative economic sluggishness relative to their own standards. So, for instance, in 2010, the Chinese economy expanded 10.4%. This year's forecast, 8.0%, except that yesterday we got a note from the International Monetary Fund, and that forecast has now been downgraded to 7.75%. The Indian economy in 2010 expanded 10.1%. You can see the forecast this year, 5.7%. The Brazilian economy, one of the most sophisticated, diversified economies in the emerging world, leaders in alternative energy production among many other cutting-edge segments, a group of people who've been wildly productive in recent years, despite the fact that they're rarely at work and are never fully clothed. This country expanded 7.5% in 2010. This year's forecast, 3.0%, and that was downgraded from earlier this year from 3.5%. So wherever you look, by and large, there's sluggishness. There's this one country here for which the economic outlook has been upgraded, and that is Japan. The Japanese have another stimulus package ongoing. And so their growth, expected growth for 2013 has been upgraded to 1.6%, better than the original forecast, which was less than 1% coming into the year. Now, before I go to that next slide, let me make this point. You know, and we're just 2 days from Memorial Day, so, you know, one feels a bit patriotic. And, you know, and one of the things in which we Americans take great pride is the fact that we're not worst. And as it turns out, one of the keys to happiness is always having somebody upon whom you can look down. And for us, that would, of course, be the Europeans. And we like to attribute our superior performance vis-a-vis the Europeans to a number of different factors. Our more flexible labor markets, our greater propensity towards entrepreneurship and innovation, our superior higher educational institutions, including institutions in this county, for instance. The fact that we're better looking because the Europeans are largely inbred. And while all of these things are true, the fact of the matter is that if America were dealing with her debt issue, the way some European societies have been trying to, at least, our economic performance would be no better than the Europeans, arguably would be worse. Now, last federal fiscal year, the federal fiscal year that ended September 30th of 2012, this nation ran a $1.1 trillion federal budget deficit. That was the fourth consecutive year of trillion-dollar plus deficits. Our accumulated national debt is now in the range of $16.5 to $16.7 trillion. It is good news, of course, that recent projections have indicated that the budget deficit for fiscal year 2013, the current fiscal year, has shrunk significantly. According to the Congressional Budget Office, this year the total budget deficit will be $642 billion, which is still a big number, don't get me wrong. $642 billion is still a big number, but it would be the first year in five that we would not have run a trillion-dollar plus deficit. Now here what I'm showing you is accumulated debt divided by gross domestic product. For a select group of nations, these are 2012 data. Now you can see at the top here the Japanese, where the debt-to-GDP ratio is now almost 250%. And if you ask the question, has Japanese debt been downgraded in recent years, the answer is, yes, it has been on four separate occasions. Italy, no surprise here to anybody in this audience that Italy has a debt problem, and then comes America. And as I say, the standing debt-to-GDP ratio as of right now is around 106%. Our debt, as I say, is $16.5 to $16.7 trillion. Our economy will produce around $15.8 trillion in output this year. If you do the math, it's around 106% debt-to-GDP. Interestingly, some nations that have not been required by the bond markets, you see, the reason that the Europeans are working, the Spanish, the Italians, the Greeks, so on and so forth, have been raising taxes and cutting spending, austerity, is that the bond markets have said to these countries, we will not lend to your governments unless you shrink your budget gaps, because unless you shrink your budget gaps, you have no credibility with us. And we're going to be your creditors, and we want to be paid back. And we don't think you can pay us back, and so we're not going to lend to you. Shrink your budget deficits, and we'll get back to you. And that's what these governments have been doing. No one has said that to America. No one has said that to America. This morning, the 10-year Treasury is yielding 2.13%. The 5-year Treasury is yielding roughly 1.0%, meaning people are lending to the federal government on a 5-year basis and asking for what in return? Give me 1% each year. That's it. That's basically inflation. Inflation right now is running around 0.9%. So no one has said that to the U.S. government, and no surprise, the Americans aren't responding with particular aggressiveness regarding their deficits. Now, it's interesting that certain countries here, like the U.K. and Canada, are, despite the fact that the bond markets haven't said anything. So in Canada, Prime Minister Stephen Harper is trying to close their budget gap by fiscal year 2015. Just to give you some sense, 2015 is just around the corner. The Republican Party is saying, we have a balanced budget. In year 10 of our budget, we'll be balanced. And well on our way to paying down the deficit. Who said that this morning? Paul Ryan on CNBC. In year 10. Well, the Canadians are trying to do that in 2 years. The English, same thing. And so those economies are growing more slowly. In other words, we have a problem in our hands still. And one of the reasons the deficit this year will be a bit smaller than had been anticipated is that Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae sent checks to the federal government that the federal government was expecting in a sum of around $62 billion. So some of this is one time and some of this is quite artificial. In any case, an issue also for Maryland, but we'll talk more about this as we get into the Maryland-specific data. Now, you wouldn't know that we have a spending problem in this country from the financial markets, though. As I said, the bond markets have been well-behaved. Yes, it's true. Some of you point out to me, Anibon, interest rates have been rising recently. That's true. But not because people are worried about the federal government paying back their debts. They've been rising for the stock market, I don't know if you've been noticing, has been soaring. And so the stock market has become relatively more attractive, and so the bond market, and I'm personifying the bond market here, the bond market has to work harder to attract money. So what does that have to do? It has to raise interest rates. So interest rates are rising. What did the Dow Jones close yesterday? Did the Dow Jones have a good day yesterday? It did. Close at 15,409.39. And you can see here a 2011 performance for the top 12 stock exchanges in our world. Now, 2011, so I'm showing you some history here. But again, you would not know from this ranking in terms of performance that the Americans have a spending problem. Capital is still flowing here. So this is the rank by size of exchange to your left. The number one rank belongs to the New York Stock Exchange, the index measure for that, the Dow Jones Industrial Average, which was up yesterday, will be down this morning. By 9:30, you'll be poorer than you are now. That's my first forecast. But it was up 5.5% in 2011. Now, you might say, Anibon, 5.5% doesn't impress me. There's supposed to be some correspondence between risk and reward. And if you're in the equity markets in 2011, you took on a ton of risk to be there. You might remember in that year, seemingly on a daily basis, 200 and 300 point swings on the Dow. You might remember the correction in August and September of that year. And in return for all that risk taking, 5.5% on the NASDAQ, negative 1.8% on the S&P 500, which is merely an index, it's not an exchange, so it's not up here. But how much did the S&P return in 2011? 0.0%. You know how long it takes to save for retirement at 0.0%? The Academy of Finance can tell you almost forever. And yet, best performance in the world. Now, who's at the bottom here? As it turns out, it's the Borsa Italiana. So you can see from the financial market's performance, the Italians have a problem. You can't see that from the Americans. 2012, similar circumstance. Yes, the rankings in terms of performance change. But the NASDAQ was up healthily 16%, the Dow was up 7%, the S&P was up 13%. The S&P was up yesterday again, closed above 1600. So, 1660.06, I believe, is where the S&P 500 closed yesterday. Fabulous. And by the way, again, look at the bottom here, the Bolsa de Madrid. So again, you can see Europe's problems are sort of reflected in these financial market performance. You don't see it from America. And that's one of the aspects of being, maybe, perhaps, arguably, the strongest economy of the developed world. Capital is flowing here. One of these days, and here's the fear, the bond market's going to look at us and say, you know what? We could invest in Europe if we wanted to. Right now, we're avoiding Europe. But one of these days, that might change. We might put money back into India. We might put money back into China, so on and so forth. And now we're worried about you, America. Are you going to be able to pay back your debts? And to pay back those debts, are you going to have to print money? You might remember late last year the discussion of the trillion-dollar coins that would be issued, sort of almost like Franklin Mint coins, but they're actually worth $1 trillion. Just print 15 of those, you're done with it. Yeah, but you trigger what? Inflation, of course. And bond investors don't like inflation, as you know. That's the crisis, and what I think many sagacious policymakers are talking about, both Democrat and Republican these days, is how do we preempt the crisis? But unfortunately, not enough of them are talking about the crisis. And so we continue to run these large deficits, probably unsustainable. But you would know it from the performance of the financial markets. If you look at 2012 S&P performance last year, almost everything was up. Financials, banks, brokerages, insurance companies, the share prices of those publicly traded companies on average, on the S&P 500, were up 23.5%, not bad. That tells you what, financials are getting healthier. Second here is consumer discretionary. What's that? Consumer discretionary relates to companies that produce what people want as opposed to what they need, like Coach handbags and Lululemon yoga pants and stuff like that. You don't need Lululemon yoga pants, you look awesome in them, by the way. But you want them, and those consumer discretionary categories, that 19.9%, the consumer is spending, and I'll talk more about that later on in the presentation. Healthcare, technology, industrials, materials. I think we can agree from an economic perspective, the recovery has been a sluggish one. It's been a moderate one. It's been a 2% one. Last year we grew 2.2%, the year before that 1.8%, the year before that 2.4%. It's been a 2% recovery the entire time. What's the forecast for this year? Roughly 2%. Now, it might turn out to be a bit better than that. We'll talk about that. But it's been a 2% recovery thus far. But from a financial market performance perspective, this has been breathtaking. As you know, the Dow Jones is more than double. More on this later on in the presentation. And if you look at corporate America, and one of the generalizations you'll hear about the U.S. economy is that corporate America is in terrific shape. By and large, I think the data support that assertion. So here again, I'm showing you too much data by half, and I know that this is small, particularly for those folks in the back. But let me walk you through some of this earnings data from the first quarter. We've received these data within the last month or so. I've divided the data into two panels, left and right. So let me start out with this left panel. The company here, CMG. CMG stands for Chipotle Mexican Grill. So the earnings estimates for Chipotle Mexican Grill was $2.13 per share. That's what the analysts expected for that company. How much did the company deliver? $2.45 per share. So they beat their earnings estimate by 32 cents a share. That was a positive surprise. That's how much we ate as a people during the first quarter. VFC, VF Corporation is one you might not have heard of, but it's sort of a brand roll-up play. So they control brands like Wrangler, Lee, Timberland, Nautica, retail category. And consumers have been shopping, including on discretionary items. And so that surprised the upside, 24 cents a share. United Technologies, BTU, Dow Chemical, Honeywell, all industrials. And the industrials are doing fine, and I'll talk about industrial America later on. And of course, industrial America is very important to Carroll County, as Carroll County is one of the most industrial counties in Maryland. But we'll talk more about that as we go through the presentation. DD right here, I don't know if you can see DD. Sir, when I say to you double D's on this beautiful morning, what are you thinking? What's going through your head? I know you.
Dunkin' Donuts.
Thank you very much. That's what I was thinking. And DD, just for the Academy of Finance people, does not stand for Dunkin' Donuts. It stands for DuPont. So if you look at this, Peabody Energy, Dow, Honeywell, DuPont, United Technologies, my goodness, that tells you a story about corporate America, about the industrial sector of the economy, that we are producing more. Exports are flat, largely because the global economy is weak, but we're gaining market share. And then if you look at things from a macroeconomic perspective, you also see signs of progress. 4 years ago when I came here, all 50 state economies were in recession, meaning that all 50 states were suffering losses in gross state products, local output, including Maryland. 4 years ago, as of May of 2009. Today, no state economy is in recession, none. So, red states in red are in recession, no states in red. States in tan, like Wisconsin, Illinois, Connecticut, Rhode Island, Alabama, Maine, these are states that are at risk of recession because they have slowed significantly recently. They don't have a lot of momentum economically for various reasons. The states in blue, including our own state of Maryland, in recovery still, growing at roughly the national rate of growth, around 2%. Some of these states in the West are growing probably closer to 3%. Some of these states are growing probably closer to 1%, but they're growing and not at risk of recession. And then five states in green, Alaska, Texas, Oklahoma, South Dakota, North Dakota, these are the nation's fastest growing state economies, or at least they have been over the past year, in terms of gross state product. These states are at the vanguard of the U.S. economic recovery, and no state is a peer in terms of economic growth to this one right here, the nation's fastest growing state by far, North Dakota. North Dakota is booming, perhaps you've heard. Now the state is not going to lift all of our fortunes with it. The state is only home to 700,000 people, somewhat less than the population of Baltimore County, 810,000 people. But it is booming. And from an economic growth perspective, it is the healthiest state economy. So if you're familiar with North Dakota, you are unusual. But you know, if you are familiar, that Fargo, the state's largest town, is right here. And if you go north along the Minnesota border from there, you'll get toward Grand Forks. The state's capital and one of its three largest cities is Bismarck. It's in the south central part of the state, right around here. And if you go northwest from there, you'll get to a town, the fourth largest town in North Dakota. It's a town called Minot, North Dakota. The Chamber of Commerce slogan there being, why not Minot? And if you've ever been there, many reasons. But 100 miles west of Minot is a town called Williston, North Dakota, and Williston has the distinction of being the fastest growing small city in America. What's that about? Back in shale, oil production in particular. Oil prices are still quite high. Natural gas prices, as you know, have been low, fallen significantly over the past 5 years, but oil prices are still quite high, $94 a barrel today, and so those who produce oil generate enormous profitability. And this is what we're seeing in northwest North Dakota, and they are booming. And this back and shale formation spreads into Montana and up into Canada. And notice how our vocabulary has changed with technology. So a few years ago, I'm quite sure you were probably not talking about Barnett Shale, and you're not talking about Fayetteville Shale, or Utica Shale, or even Marcellus Shale. And as you know, Maryland has some of this potential to produce energy, to participate in the energy revolution taking place in America, the energy production revolution. We have, as everyone knows here, Marcellus Shale right here in far western Maryland, Garrett and Allegheny counties. Now, the Pennsylvanians, when they understood this new technology, this potential of hydraulic fracturing and horizontal drilling and natural gas production, how many jobs that could create, and so on and so forth, how much in tax revenues, they jumped all over it. You know what they started doing when they saw the opportunity? They started drilling wells. So when the Pennsylvanians see economic opportunity, they jump all over it. In Maryland, we study it. We're now in the midst of a 3-year study, and it is going to be an excellent study. I really think that. Very much. So watch out, Pennsylvania. And this energy boom will continue, by the way. According to the International Energy Agency, by the year 2020, in fact, before the year 2020, America will be the largest producer of oil. We're presently third. We'll, by that point, have surpassed the Saudis and the Russians. This year we'll produce more than 7 million barrels of oil per day in this country. Last year we produced 6.4 million barrels per day, the year before that 5.6 million barrels per day. We are basically self-sufficient already in natural gas. By the year 2030, according to the International Energy Agency, by 2030 we'll be self-sufficient in energy again, as we were in the 1950s. By the way, who is the world's largest consumer of oil? That would be the Chinese. And if we're the largest producer and they're the largest consumer, does that not alter trade relations between the two countries? In fact, does not completely alter the geopolitical structure of the world, it does. And I can tell you the Russians, the Saudis, the Venezuelans, and many others are quite nervous about America's newfound energy production potential. And the technology around this is getting better and better. And from an environmental perspective as well. America's on the move, at least on that along that dimension, but other dimensions as well. Take industrial production as an example. America's become an increasingly fashionable place in which to produce. They might have heard about 5 or 6 weeks ago, Airbus announced the groundbreaking of a new $600 million plant in Mobile, Alabama. Caterpillar last year announced the reshoring of production from Japan, bringing that work back to America, Victoria, Texas, and Athens, Georgia. NCR, formerly National Cash Register, is bringing back work to America, this time to Columbus, Georgia. Whirlpool has announced that they're bringing back work to America, this time to Clyde, Ohio, about 73 miles west of Cleveland. And by the way, Whirlpool has a large plant under construction, under development in Cleveland, Tennessee. And then Chesapeake Bay Candle announced they're going to bring back production to America, this time to Glen Burnie, Maryland. Why is America becoming a more fashionable place in which to produce? Because we have fashioned ourselves for many, many years as a nation of consumers. Increasingly, we're going to have to brand ourselves as a nation of producers rather than the form of industrial products or energy. Well, cheapest natural gas prices in the world help, that's for sure. And I think that's one of the great sources of potential for Carroll County, Maryland as well. There's not a lot of counties in Maryland that can boast this array of mid-sized manufacturers. Knorr Brake, of course, have been mentioned earlier, very much at the cutting edge of technology, but there are many others in this county. And all of a sudden, America has become a more fashionable place in which to produce. Now, if you're a Marylander, and we all are, I assume, we've got some policy issues. For instance, it is true, and you may think that this is a non-factor, and we don't need to have this debate now, but as it turns out, we're not a right-to-work state. And much of the investment I've seen in industrial production in this country has taken place in right-to-work states, the largest factories, Tennessee, Alabama, so on and so forth, Louisiana. Second, you know, we have this new stormwater tax. Maybe you've heard of this. You know, for centuries, kings, queens, monarchs, emperors, dictators, chieftains, prime ministers tried to figure out how do I tax rain? And it was not until Martin O'Malley and the state's legislature that we actually figure out as a world, across the world, you can tax literally anything. So, now here's the problem from an industrial perspective though. And you might like the stormwater tax very much and you know upgrading sewer and water capacity, that's fine, that's not the debate I'm having. But here's the problem from an economic development perspective. Industrial facilities tend to be horizontal. They're not like office buildings, vertical, they're horizontal, meaning they're associated with significant impervious surface. It's a very competitive world, as you know, in the world of manufacturing. Price matters. A lot of these are commodities. So the decision to buy or not to buy is made on the basis of price. So you've got industrial facilities, and they can't compete fully because you've got, for instance, a rain tax, but also not a right to work state. There's sort of an accretion here of factors. Then we can't participate in this industrial production renaissance like we would want. Now, it's true, in April, industrial production was off just a bit. I'll talk more about that later on. I wouldn't worry too much about it. The most recent data that we received, the sort of intra-monthly data, the weekly data, have suggested that May will be better for industrial production. And then gross domestic product, 15 consecutive quarters of economic growth in America, culminated with a 2.5% performance on an annualized basis during the first quarter of 2013. Not horrible. Not great, not horrible. And I can break down this 2.5% for you to show you what's actually growing in this economy. And that's what I'm doing with this slide. Now, I've got too much data on here by half. I've got 5 quarters of data and 4 categories, so 20 data points. Too much by half. But let me just walk through this a little bit. Let's just focus on these green colored bars. There's 4 green colored bars here. That'll be the subject of our focus. Why? because that pertains to first quarter 2013 data, the most recent data that we have available. So this is the green colored bars. Okay, so if you look at this, this number right here that is associated with personal consumption, that's 2.2. Government spending, negative 0.8, net exports, which is exports minus imports, negative 0.5, and this with gross investment, that's business investment by and large, 1.6%. If you add up these four numbers, the 2.2, the negative 0.8, the negative 0.5, and the 1.6, you'll get that 2.5% number. So what I'm doing for you is I'm breaking down that 2.5% number. Now notice, in the first quarter, two items subtracted from economic growth. They were government spending, of course. Government spending is a drag right now, a headwind on economic growth. Sequestration began in March, though the real effects won't be felt until the second quarter, when the second quarter data come out. But government spending subtracted 0.8% from first quarter growth, because there wasn't much government spending. And then second, net exports down 0.5%. By the way, when I say not much government spending, this includes state and local. It's not just federal, when I say that statement. There was plenty of federal spending, but overall in the public sector, that was actually a subtraction from growth. And then net exports, negative 0.5. Why? Well, our exports are having a tough time. Why are our exporters having a tough time? Because the rest of the world economy is pretty weak, particularly Europe. And so net exports subtract 0.5%. Now gross investment, business investment, added 1.6%. Notice the pattern here. You see this? You see this up one quarter, then not so much, then up, then not so much, then up. Why is that happening? Because what's driving these quarterly fluctuations is inventory buildup. So inventories fall, people order inventory builds up again, and that shows up as investment and is positive for economic growth. But now that I've got inventories, what do I want to do? I want to sell down the inventories, and I don't want to order a lot of new inventory. And so that's a down quarter. So up, down, up, down, up. Guess what the next quarter is? Well, it's a rhetorical question, but thank you for participating. That's right. So in the second quarter, which is the next quarter will be the second quarter for the purpose of these data, it's not going to be government spending, it's not going to be net exports, it's not going to be gross investment. That leaves only one person standing from a growth perspective, that's personal consumption. And now you can see one of the real problems of the U.S. economic expansion, it's so dependent still upon consumer spending. Now thankfully the stock market is surging, and we are seeing more jobs, I'll talk about that in a subsequent part of the presentation, and that's important. But it's not a diversified recovery. It's a four-cylinder economy, four-cylinder recovery. It's energy, housing, consumer spending, stock market. Four cylinders out of eight. And so that gets you 2%. So let me talk about the labor market now. Because if consumption is the main driver still in our economic recovery, that means that the job market and income growth remain extremely important. Are we adding jobs in America? Answer, yes we are. The last number that we received on this was for April. In April, the nation added 165,000 jobs. That beat the consensus estimate, which had been 150,000. Not bad. But the big news for the April jobs report was not the 165,000. It was the upward revisions to previous months. So when we first got the March jobs report, the government indicated that in March, the nation had added 88,000 jobs. That was an upgrade to 138,000 jobs. Now that's reflected on this graph. The February initial estimate came in at 236,000 jobs. That was upgraded to 332,000 jobs. So if you look at job growth from sort of a long-term perspective, not just the last few months, you can see it's been pretty steady. And over the past year, the nation has added 2.077 million jobs. This is a breakdown of those 2.077 million jobs by industry. Now at the top of the list, in terms of job augmentation, is professional and business services. These are white-collar jobs, auditors and accountants, for instance. Attorneys, we have not created a lot of jobs for attorneys in this economy, not yet. Architects, other white-collar professionals. But a lot of the job growth in this professional business services category, which added 587,000 jobs between April of 2012 and April of 2013, a lot of the jobs in this professional business services grouping were in business services. And business services includes, among other things, people who work for temporary staffing agencies. And there's been a lot of temporary job creation in America. And why would there be? Is the economy growing? Yes, it is. Are some organizations therefore becoming busier, getting busier? Yes, they are. Do they therefore need to staff up, at least to a degree? Yes, they do. Do they have enough confidence to take on full-time staff? Not necessarily. So they're busier. They may need more people. If they can find temporary people, they might just do that. And then on top of that, and this is a big point of discussion in the economics community, January 1st, 2014, major provisions of the Affordable Care Act are fully implemented, including the individual mandate. Do I want to hire more full-time workers now when I don't know what healthcare premiums are going to look like this year and next? Maybe not, maybe I hold off, and if I can substitute full-time workers with temporary workers, I might just do that. Second category here is the supply chain. Retail trade, wholesale trade, transportation, and utilities. Transportation was in the news a lot yesterday, notice. We had a cruise ship catch on fire, and we had a train derailment. And now it's Wednesday morning, we'll see what happens today. But this is a sector that has prospered, has had 428,000 jobs over the past year. Why is the supply chain getting busier? We're buying more, we're producing more. Third, leisure and hospitality. What does that tell you? The leisure and hospitality has had 278,000 jobs over the past year. We're spending. We're spending on discretionary items, including vacations. And we have been for quite some time. Ocean City has been sold out the last couple of summers. It'll be sold out again this summer. Not just because the economy has gotten better and consumers are spending, but because of what happened in New Jersey. And not all the New Jersey seaside resorts are back online. Some are, some are not. So we're going to have a lot of folks from New Jersey coming down to Maryland this year. I don't view that as a positive. But it is an economic reality, we have to deal with it. And it affects me personally too, I must tell you. I'm from Baltimore, so, and I fly a fair amount to various presentations. And so I'm on Southwest Airlines a lot, and that's primary carrier for BWI, so no surprise. And Southwest does not have assigned seating. As you know, they issue an alphanumeric, which tells you when you may board the plane, and the best is A1. A1 is the best, C20 is the worst, something like this. Because I travel so much on Southwest, and I don't mean to brag, I'm A-list preferred. I'm business select. What does that mean? It means I get to board the plane first. Typically A1 through A15. My most recent flight from Boston, I was A5. I'm just saying. And then I consider a window and aisle my pleasure, my choice. And then as the rest of the mass is boarding, what is my principal aspiration at that moment in economic history? What do I want more than anything else on God's green earth? I want the middle seat empty. That's exactly right. Why is it so important to me? I have no idea. But it's like an obsession that it be empty. So you know what I do to try to protect it? I'll do the angry foreigner thing. I'll menacing, I'll put my shoes. Anything I can do. And you know what's so shameful about that, I find? It never works. Because as a flight crew will tell you, this plane is completely full. And it is, generally. At least with Southwest Airlines. And it's a function of the fact that leisure and hospitality is trending higher. Other sectors adding jobs, education, health services, construction adding jobs. It's been a long time since I could tell you that construction was adding a material number of jobs. It is now, and that has a lot to do with the housing market, something I'll talk about in a moment. Maryland's done just fine. I know a lot of us complain about the business climate, at least I do. I worry about taxation and fees and regulations, maybe you do too, maybe you don't. But the fact of the matter is, for now, the data held up pretty well. Over the past year, this data has added 34,600 jobs, 1.3% of job total. While the nation had 1.6% of job total. So are we adding jobs as fast as the rest of the nation? We are not, but we're close. No surprise, leading the way, segments like professional business services, education, health services, construction, and it might surprise you to note that government has actually added jobs over the past year. But notice, some aspects of government are getting bigger, isn't that true? State government is not shrinking. And sequestration would not have had much effect on these data. This is Baltimore metropolitan area data. Baltimore Metro has done just fine. 26,200 jobs over the past year, of course, Carroll County, part of the Baltimore primary metropolitan statistical area. And then Washington Metro, 41,500 jobs over the past year. Not terrible. 1.4% of job totals. So the region is still growing. And one of the things about Carroll County that's really spectacular, and I was talking to a young man in insurance the other day. I spoke at an insurance conference in Anne Arundel County, and he said, I just moved to Carroll County. And I asked, why did you move to Carroll County? Beautiful county, obviously. Why did you move to Carroll County? Because I can get jobs in Washington, D.C. I can find work in Baltimore Metro. I'm part of the deepest labor market, or one of the deepest labor markets in the country by living in Carroll County, and I can still enjoy this quality of life. You can't get better than this. Carroll County is a real advantage being able to participate in two major labor markets, and Washington and Baltimore thus far have held up pretty well. This is employment growth for the 50 U.S. states and the District of Columbia. The lowest, so this is employment growth, so the fastest employment growth over the past year, North Dakota. North Dakota has added 3.7% of its job totals over the past year. Who's second? Utah. Now, Utah is another natural resource intensive state, but notice also very good business climate. And many companies that are in Silicon Valley are using Utah as their expansion platform from an operational perspective. So the innovation might still take place in Cupertino, California, for instance, wherever it takes place, but the operations often flow to places like Utah, lower taxes, less expensive labor. Texas, Colorado, and Idaho round out the top five. What is this all about? Largely about natural resources. Not exclusively, but largely about natural resource intensivity. Number 20 here is Maryland, 1.3%. And one of the things the governor notes is that Maryland is adding jobs more rapidly presently than is Virginia, 1.0%. Now, the Virginians are relatively more susceptible or vulnerable to federal government cutbacks, including in the form of procurement. Why is this? Because they've won so much procurement in previous years. Starting in the early 1990s, the federal government began to change the way it procured items. So you might remember in the early 1990s, we were living with the aftermath of the Ronald Reagan Tipper Neal era deficits. They wanted to make federal government more efficient, reinvention of government, including in terms of procurement processes. A gentleman named Stephen Kelman came down from Harvard University, John Kennedy School of Government, and took over some of these operations. And his idea was, let's have fewer procurements. Every time we have a procurement, it costs us money to write up the documents, so on and so forth, bid protests and handling the bid protests. Let's have fewer procurements. Let's bundle these contracts together. Let's bundle. So we'll have many different tasks under one contract. Now, who can do all those tasks under one contract? Large contractors. They have the capacity to be able to adjust to so many different types of work. Well, where are the large contractors disproportionately located? Northern Virginia. So since that time, Northern Virginia's share of total government procurement, federal government procurement in the Washington area has grown by leaps and bounds. If you go around Dulles Airport, you'll see all the, you can't believe it, isn't that right? All these tall buildings with federal government contracts, you can't believe the government can spend this much money to support this much employment. If you go to suburban Maryland, you'll see office buildings too, but not as many. Which means that the Virginians, and also if you think about Hampton Roads, down in the Tidewater area, the major military base there, and the Newport News and all the shipbuilding that they do there, a lot of it federally contracted. They're more vulnerable than Virginians to federal government cutbacks, and that's one of the reasons that they're actually adding jobs more slowly than is Maryland over the past year. And this is unemployment rates for the same 50 U.S. states. The lowest unemployment rate is in North Dakota. You see the pattern here? Other natural resource-intensive states with low rates of unemployment, Nebraska, South Dakota, Iowa, Utah, Wyoming, Oklahoma, Kansas, Montana, Alaska, Idaho, Texas, Louisiana, West Virginia. West Virginia's unemployment rate is just 0.1% above ours on a seasonally adjusted basis. And that tells you about the power of natural resources. And this is unemployment rate for the large 20 metropolitan areas in our country. The lowest unemployment rate among the 20 large metropolitan areas is still Washington, D.C. So all this talk about federal government cutbacks, sequestration, so on and so forth, I'm quite sure this will affect the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area eventually. Hasn't shown up in the data too much yet. And by the way, a report came out yesterday saying that among the major markets in the country, no one has as strong of a housing market as the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area. Second here is Minneapolis. Fabulous business climate. These people have birthed many of America's most successful enduring companies. Best Buy, Target, 3M, Cargill, General Mills, United Health. A couple of banks I won't mention because BB&T is our sponsor. BB&T. Banking and shipping, or whatever you're. Fabulous. These are giants. Best Buy is a giant. Target is a giant. Target, which is a privately held company, is a giant. 3M is a giant. I will now name for you the Fortune 500 companies in the Baltimore metropolitan area. And there it is. Thank you very much. Drive home safely. That's it. They are none. Now, we do have four Fortune 1000 companies, those being T. Rowe Price, Legg Mason, W.R. Grace, and McCormick Foods. Under Armour, I suspect, will one of these days join the Fortune 1000 category. Apparently not yet in the Fortune rankings. But
but the fact that the corporate environment in Minneapolis, Boston, another educated market, and Seattle, rounding up the top four. San Francisco is down here at number 8, and then Baltimore Taos in our region at 7%. For a long time, San Francisco and Baltimore were tied. San Francisco now has the edge on Baltimore by 0.1%, but did not have the edge on February 3rd. Baltimore 34, San Francisco 31. Now, again, and I know there's some mixed feelings here, I get that, the Carroll County crowd, I get it. But, now, 24 jurisdictions in Maryland, which is nice for the office on one slide. So this is the unemployment rate for Maryland's jurisdiction. Now, the April data, Brian and I were talking about this earlier, will come out to the public at 10 a.m. Yeah, come on, you have it already. The public doesn't get it until 10 a.m. So in 25 minutes, you will get the new Carroll County number. I'm not supposed to tell you what it is. You can see it's 6.1% in March. I'm not supposed to tell you what it is for April. It's 5.4%. So now you know. No one else knows that. Oh, yes, we broke a story there. Somebody needs to run to their typewriter. Now, notice the federal orientation of the jurisdictions with the lowest rates of unemployment. Howard County, home to many federal workers and workers and federal contractors. Montgomery County, the Washington, D.C. area suburb, as is Carroll County, as is Frederick County. St. Mary's County is not home, is not a part of any major metropolitan area, but it's home to the Patuxent River Naval Air Station. It's large and important by far, another federal installation in Maryland, the P1. Anne Arundel County, of course, is home to many federal workers, federal contractors, works of federal contractors, so on and so forth. And Charles County is another Washington, D.C. area suburb. So all of these seven jurisdictions with low rates of unemployment, disproportionately low rates of unemployment, are very much federally oriented. Among the jurisdictions that are not touched to that degree by the federal government, the lowest unemployment rate actually is in Carroll County. Carroll County. And note, now I'm not, by the way, I'm not suggesting to you the federal government has no influence here. Obviously, it does. But not the same way that it does in Anne Arundel County. And there's nothing in Carroll County like the National Security Agency, before George G.B. generally. And so Carroll County stands out. And I'd say one of the sort of one of the reasons for this is obviously A, it's an educated population. But B, access to major labor markets. So if you lose a job in one place, there's a chance in the labor market that's deep, you could find a job someplace else. Notice on the right-hand side here, the jurisdiction with high rates of unemployment is largely Maryland's Eastern Shore. And this is what Maryland looks like when the federal government is not very much involved. So Worcester County, Somerset, Dorchester, Cecil, Wicomico, Caroline, Talbot, Kent, all Eastern Shore jurisdictions. The only one of the Eastern Shore jurisdictions that's not on this side is Queen Anne's County. Queen Anne's a suburb of Anne Arundel County, basically. So that's what Maryland looks like without the federal government playing a major role. And, you know, for rural Maryland, I find it's very tough. I mean, what can rural Maryland actually do? What are they allowed to do? Are they allowed to grow chickens? No, maybe not. The farm? Eh, with limitations. Can you build a house? No. No. But we do want you to pay your taxes. Tough for rural Maryland to compete. And no surprise, really very high unemployment rates here, and actually one of the more sluggish housing markets you'll find in Maryland. You'll find them large by and large on the Eastern Shore. This is employment net change. Now, I want to be clear, this is not the number of jobs in the county. This is a reflection of the number or the change in the number of people who live in Carroll County with jobs. People who live in Carroll County with jobs. And that has been on the rise on a year-over-year basis. The county's coming back. There's no question about it. You can see the labor market data. You can see the unemployment rate data. So, did a six-month moving average on the data. You can see the trend here. You can see how bad unemployment got in 2009, 2010. But you can see it's been a pretty linear decline now in unemployment. And as I say, the April number is going to be quite good, 5.4%. 5.4%, that's quite good. So let me talk about now about the housing market. I know you're interested in the housing market, and here also you see signs of improvement. And one of the reasons for this is, well, what I'm reflecting here, record low or near record low mortgage rates. Fantastic. At least if you're a borrower. These interest rates, having low interest rates is not a good thing if you're on fixed income. I understand that. I understand that. There's good and bad associated with low interest rates. But certainly for the housing market, it's a good thing. Here I'm showing you data from Freddie Mac. I'm showing you the 15-year fixed mortgage rate in red and the 30-year fixed mortgage rate in blue. We have the data now for April The 30-year fixed mortgage rate average for April, 3.45%. 30-year fixed, 3.45%. Now, you've gotten used to these rates, I think. But if, from a few years ago, this is astonishing. This is astonishing. How insanely low is a 3.45% on a 30-year fixed? I would not offer to my own older daughter, Kimaya Basu, age 14, a 30-year fixed at 3.45%. I love her now. We have a terrific relationship. Who knows in 30 years? Now, I'm not a monster. I'm not a monster. I'm an engaged father when I see her. So I'd give her a 7-year arm. But a 30-year fixed, I think that's entirely the wrong message. Now, predictably, in a nation that's added almost 2.1 million jobs over the past year, and a state that's added roughly 35,000 jobs over the past year, and with mortgage rates this low, and with many Americans still deleveraging, meaning they're paying down their debt, and one of the aspects of paying down debt is that your credit score goes up. So people, some people at least, who could not qualify necessarily for mortgages at the beginning of the cycle, may be getting closer. And the housing market, therefore, is gearing up, and you can see it in the data. This is U.S. new home sales. Now, you might be surprised that there has not been more improvement in new home sales. This is new as opposed to existing. You might say, well, honey, but that doesn't look that impressive. This is kind of recovery. See, it's true. But one of the reasons that new home sales haven't really picked up is that the builders haven't built much yet for buyers to buy. Now, some of that has to do with public policy, as you know it. In a country like this, it can take some time to pull a permit. Maybe you view that as a good thing, maybe not so much. I do see some developers here. But that's why you don't see much of an improvement in new home sales. That's beginning to change. Because the builders are trying to build. The builders are trying to build. Now you might say, Anibon, I just read that home builder confidence is falling. Home builder confidence is not falling because there aren't enough buyers out there now. Home builder confidence is falling because land prices are skyrocketing, materials prices are rising, and labor is getting more expensive too. In part because so many construction workers left the industry during the downturn. But if you look at housing starts, now look at this April number. That doesn't look too good, does it? No, that doesn't look too good. Why did that happen? Well, what was April like? Do you remember what it was like? What were you wearing in April? A coat. Why? Because it's cold. And what does that affect? Construction, among other things. So that April number is really about the weather. If you look at the permits data, right, people getting permission to build homes, permits were, no pun intended, through the roof in April. And it tells me that summer will be a very active period of building throughout America in terms of housing. This is one of the reasons that builders are building. And also one of the reasons that people are thinking of buying. Home prices are rising again. When I came here last year or the year before and the year before that, home prices were still falling. If not in reality, then in perception. And so if I'm a prospective buyer, what's my optimal strategy in a market in which home prices are falling? It's to wait. The longer I wait, the less I pay. That's no longer the case. Prices are rising, up 19% over the past year in San Francisco, 18% in Las Vegas, up in Washington, D.C. by 7%. By a different measure, Washington, D.C. is actually doing much better than this. Housing inventory is down. So one of the issues, of course, was, earlier in the cycle, too many homes for sale, not enough buyers. Many realtors, and there are some realtors in the audience, I recognize them, will tell you the problem I have right now is not a lack of buyers, I don't have enough product that I can sell to those buyers. The inventory of unsold homes throughout the Baltimore metropolitan area has fallen significantly over the past year. So what I'm showing you here, this orange color bar, is April 2012 inventory of unsold homes measured in months of supply. So for instance, Anne Arundel County, a year ago, 5.7 months of supply, now 4.3 months. In Carroll County, a year ago, 7.9 months, now down below 6. 6 we view as the mythical equilibrium. It is said that below 6 months, the market is really tightened up. 5.7 months in Carroll County. And this is Carroll County housing unit sales, up on a year-over-year basis. It's getting more active. It no longer makes as much sense to wait. Now, it must be terribly frustrating for people whose credit scores are just not quite good enough to allow them to transact in this kind of market and take advantage of these historically low interest rates. And to still buy at a low basis. Even though we've seen an improvement in home prices recently, home prices in general are still about 20-25% below the pre-recession peak. I'd say it's still to you, it's a good time to be a buyer. And many prospective buyers are getting scared now. They're seeing these prices rise, and they're worried that the interest rates are going to go away with low interest rates. And so there's an urgency. There's been an urgency this spring that we have not seen for quite some time, and you can see some of that urgency reflected in the data. By the way, you might wonder, what was this? Why did this happen, Anibon? because that was still, part of this was still during the recession, that was the federal tax credits for first-time buyers. It got, so people went into the market, but then when they went into the market before they otherwise would have, they disappeared. You see what I'm saying? They weren't there to drive the next set of home sales. We're through that period, and now you can see organic improvement here. This is median home sales price. They're rising. Median home sales price is rising in Carroll County, Maryland. You can see it right here. And not particularly slowly either, in the range of 10% on a year-over-year basis. That's not a bad return on investment. This is Carroll County new housing permits. So you can see where we were pre-recession. And then you can see where we are now. Only a bit of improvement in housing permits. Not quite yet there yet. I'm quite sure that applications may be rising. I'm not sure about that. But so far we haven't seen many permits issued, whether single family or multifamily. Fine, that's my presentation. Fine. My forecast. Now we've been pretty good, I think you'd admit, those of you who've been with us for a few years, at forecasting. We have forecasted 2% for a long time, we've been right. Guess what our forecast is this year? 2%. And we'll continue to forecast that until when? Until we're proven wrong. Now, it might be a bit better than 2%, and if it's going to be better than 2%, it's because the consumer is going to end up spending more than we had anticipated. And there's a couple of things driving this. One, Americans have never been wealthier. I know that sounds like a strange thing to say, but if you look at aggregate household wealth, which is in the range of $16 trillion, it's never been higher than it is right now. The problem is that much of the accretion of wealth in recent years has been among the top 1, 2, 3, 4, 5% of Americans. So it's been very concentrated among the relative hands of a few. Why? Because much of the gain in wealth has been in financial assets. And financial assets are held in large amounts by a relatively small portion of the population. But nonetheless, wealth is being recreated, and consumer confidence is starting to bounce back. Just a little bit. In fact, we have a May number now. May was pretty good for consumer confidence. We got that yesterday. So the consumer is a bit more confident, and they're certainly spending as if they're more confident. Sales are up on a year-over-year basis. And if you look at certain categories of sales, they're up pretty significantly. So for instance, the category that includes internet sales, up 15.4% over the past year. Motor vehicles and parts dealers is a fancy way of saying auto dealers, up 7.7%. Clothing and clothing accessory stores, up 6%. Food services, drinking places, the fancy way of saying restaurants and bars, 4.5%. And that's where I really see, no pun intended again, the appetite to spend in the full-service restaurants. That's where I see Americans spending most freely. Go tonight to an Applebee's. Now, don't eat there. You're better than that. But go there from the perspective of doing economic research. It'll be busy. It's just a Wednesday night. It'll be busy, as will the Olive Garden next door and so on and so forth. Steakhouse off the street. Many of you, when you go to your favorite restaurant, will note a wait. Even on a weeknight. Furniture, home furniture stores up 4%. Sporting goods, hobby, book, and music stores up 3.1%. Gasoline station sales down 5%. That's because gas prices are actually a little bit lower this time now than they were a year ago. My penultimate slide. So where is this economy headed with all of this? Well, I think in a decent place. This will continue to be an ongoing recovery. This is my favorite leading indicator. It predicted the recession, turned negative in August of 2007, 4 months before the recession, so it predicted the recession. It turned positive about 4 months before June of 2009, predicted the end of the recession. So it has been wildly predicted. It's a great leading index. The Conference Board is a private organization in New York that also produces the Consumer Confidence Index. Now, not once during the recovery has it told us we're off to the races. Up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. So it's told us all along, don't expect anything fabulous here. It'll be a modest recovery, but it will be a recovery. We're not heading back into recession, and I think that's basically the outlook now. In fact, if you look at the early part of this year, the fourth quarter meeting, this is my final slide, January and February were better than expected. You start off the year on a good note, positive note. Consumers were spending, producers were producing. The second quarter will be a bit of a slowdown for reasons I got into. Inventories won't build up this quarter, and so the second quarter number won't be quite as good for gross domestic product. Expect something in the range of 1.5%. But the rest of the year will be just fine. Now, I could be wrong, obviously. I could be way off. I think there's a lot of threats from Washington, D.C. I'm from Baltimore, and so I can see Washington, D.C. from here. But there are threats coming from other parts of the world as well. And so what black swan does, so a black swan refers to black swan theory, which was given to us by a gentleman named Taleb. So it has nothing to do with the Natalie Portman movie of 2010. And Taleb was writing about what? Low probability events that, if they were to occur, would have major impact. 9/11 is a classic black swan event. Changed everything. Small probability. I mean, going into that day, on that beautiful Tuesday morning, who would have thought such a thing could happen? Low probability. And the theory is about how do markets and how do business decision makers and government decision makers deal with those low probability events? The Boston Marathon event, to a certain extent, black swan. Geopolitically, some of the black swans, Iran, Israel/Iran, Europe, of course, from a financial perspective. We can mention Israel and Syria. We can mention Turkey and Syria. We can mention China and Japan, the second and third largest economies in the world, respectively, and their brewing conflict. And of course, the North Koreans. When the North Koreans had a missile test placed last year with a missile from roughly me to you, madam. At the end, they had the nuclear try to lob it into South Korea. The pieces are really heavy, and it kind of goes like a girl or a stealer, so we get there. So then, I'll just say what happened. And then, so in December, they tried another long-range rocket test. This one was successful. They got a satellite, well, of course, they sent it into space. Literally a few days later, there's a third successful nuclear test. Lately, in the last couple of weeks, they've been lobbing missiles near enough to South Korea to make the South Koreans nervous. Near enough. And so this prompts the Americans to commit to investing $1 billion in their West Coast missile defense system. So there's a lot of black swan threats out there, and one of the things that's very difficult to manage in a global economy. Many headwinds remain and the recovery could easily falter. I believe that. You may or may not believe that. I know one gentleman who definitely believes it. Ben Bernanke, our federal chairman. What did Ben say last year, among other things? We will not significantly tighten monetary policy until unemployment in this country is 6.5%. Where are we today? 7.5%. Will we hit 6.5% this year? We will not. That would be my prediction. When asked earlier this year by Congress, when will we, Dr. Bernanke, hit 6.5% unemployment in America? His answer, 2015. So that accommodative monetary policy is here for quite some time. And by the way, inflation has not been accelerating, it's been decelerating recently. Down now to 0.9%, as I said earlier. So there's no reason for the Federal Reserve to focus on that part of its twin mandate. Inflation, the bigger problem is 7.5% unemployment, so they're going to continue to effectively print money. And though interest rates might rise a bit, and they have in fact, they're going to, that low interest rate regime will remain in place for the balance of the year. In 1991, a musical group called the Divinals came out with a song, "I Touch Myself." And that's basically what corporate America is doing. Earlier this year, I had predicted, along with many other people, this would be a heavy year for mergers and acquisitions. It has not been. There haven't been that many deals. There was a deal recently involving Yahoo, for instance, but by and large, there haven't been that many deals. Now, why? Because if I'm a CEO of a major company, why should I take on somebody else and take on the risk of integrating two enterprises when I can just buy my own stock, make my shareholders happy because I'm raising their stock price, or just issue them a dividend? And that's what they're doing. So companies remain largely content to buy themselves, and that might continue. And then finally, recovery in Carroll County continues. One can observe improvement in both the employment and residential real estate gains. This county is now on the move. Now, I don't think you've thought through or necessarily passed the stormwater tax yet. I don't think you've sort of established what the rate will be. Is that true or false? That's true, right? So you're thinking that through that now. That'll be a very interesting decision. Everyone, I think, is waiting in some sense for Carroll County to make this decision. And which way will you go? Will you take the Frederick County route, pass basically a nominal rate that has a very little economic consequence, or the Baltimore City route, where I think there's going to be a bit of a game changer from a development perspective, and therefore from a tax-based information perspective? I don't know. That's one of the things to watch for from a policy perspective for the balance of the year. I thank you very much for the opportunity, Carroll County Economic Development. Thank you, BB&T, for sponsoring. Thank you for making sure that the Academy of Finance got here. Thank you, Academy of Finance, for being here. Thank you very much. And thank you for questions you have in our remaining time together. Thank you.
Events,
catastrophic weather events. For instance, what we saw in Moore, Oklahoma, comes immediately to mind, but there have been others, Joplin, Missouri, so on and so forth. And does feel as if the weather has become more vicious in recent years. And the obvious explanation people have for this is, well, this is global warming. Maybe, maybe not, who knows? But set that aside, the fact of the matter is we seem to be dealing in a cycle, whether it's global warming or not, where there is more severe weather and more disruption. So if you look, for instance, at the Joplin, Missouri tornado, had that been a hurricane, it would have been the 11th most damaging hurricane in U.S. history. So even non-hurricanes, you know, are starting to have real impact economically. And of course, you mentioned the insurance industry. They're the ones most implicated by this, and the same is true in Moore, Oklahoma. I think what this means from an economic perspective is that a lot of the insurance companies have underpriced risk, meaning that they're not charging us enough from a property casualty perspective. At least this is the emerging conventional wisdom within the insurance industry. If you listen to or read the writings of thought leaders in that industry, they're telling everyone, you need to prepare for a higher degree of risk. It could come from geopolitical, it could come from the weather, but you need to think this through, and therefore charge higher rates if you do think this through, or not offer the insurance in the first place. And we've seen this, right? Haven't we seen this with flood insurance and other things? Where basically the insurance industry basically said, we're not offering that form of insurance. There's a demand for it. You're willing to pay a significant amount for it. We're not even going to offer it to you. That's scary, because insurance sounds boring, but insurance is what allows many of us to do bold things. Without insurance, we couldn't buy that house. Without insurance, we couldn't take on that contract, so on and so forth. It allows us to be bold. Take away insurance, you know, the effectiveness or the efficiency of the insurance market, because the insurers are scared. We've got a big problem. The economy becomes less bold and therefore less dynamic. Big issue. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am. Yes, this is an excellent question as well. You can say, I say it to everybody. So please don't infer anything from that. Yeah. But her question is, hey, I heard that there's a shortage of doctors in the country. Is that true? And what effect will that have? It is absolutely true. And it's remarkable that it is true so early in the game. Because we've been talking for years, of course, of the baby boomers entering their retirement years. Becoming more aggressive utilizers of healthcare and therefore requiring more physicians, along with registered nurses and lab technicians and so on and so forth. But, you know, the oldest of baby boomers this year will turn, I believe, 67, according to a conventional definition. And the big healthcare consumption years are actually in front of them, not behind them, from a generation perspective. The youngest baby boomers are still, you know, late 40s, early 50s. So the big years of healthcare consumption in front of them, and then when you add in the Affordable Care Act, and insuring people through Medicare, or Medicaid expansion, I should say, and through the health insurance changes, you're going to have even more utilization. So for us to have physician shortages already in advance of that is astonishing. And you haven't seen anything yet. Now, a lot of shortages today, many of them, not all, are in specialties. Right? Increasingly, what you're going to find, a lack of primary care physicians. Because that's what healthcare reform is all about. Getting people insured so they seek preventative care. Well, who provides that preventative care, the diagnostic care? It's the general practitioner, not necessarily the specialist. So you're going to find enormous demand for general practitioners. And the question is, are those general practitioners going to want to serve Medicare patients and Medicaid patients, given those rates of reimbursement? So you might have a doctor in the community, they still won't see us because we have the wrong form of insurance. So there's many sources of potential shortage. Physically, not enough physicians. Secondly, I'm here, but I'm irrelevant to you because I don't take your form of insurance. I'm concierge. I provide services to these businesses, and I think you'll see a lot of that too. My sense is the way the country's going to respond to this is the way it responded in the 1960s and 1970s. 1960s and 1970s were a period of tremendous immigration of foreign medical graduates. For instance, I'm in this country, why? My father came here in 1967, foreign medical graduate, University of Calcutta Medical School. And by the way, he practices in Carroll County in general, and he loves it, loves practicing. So, in any case, I think you'll see that again. Here's the issue. If I'm a U.S. educated physician, what do I probably have? A ton of debt. I can't afford to take low reimbursement. I'll never pay back that debt. So I need to go to the specialists. specialty categories, so I can generate enough income to pay back this debt. If I'm a Ford medical graduate, my medical education costs less, I don't have as much debt, so I can afford to be a general practitioner. You'll see a lot of importing of general practitioners from abroad going forward. Yes, ma'am. Yes, this is a very good question. I mean it this time. Her question is, you talk about higher education and where this is going, tuition. But as you know, tuition has been rising by leaps and bounds, not just in private, among private schools, but among public schools as well, though the increase has been more rapid in the private category. As you might also know, the aggregate level of student debt in this country has now surpassed $1 trillion. That student debt now exceeds credit card debt in total. Student debt is on the second leading category of debt behind only mortgages. As you know also, there, a lot of the student debt is delinquent. People are having a tough time paying this back. As you might also know, on July 1st, Stafford loans were set to be repriced in terms of interest rates from 3.4% to 6.8%. It was actually supposed to happen last year, but during the election year it didn't happen. It might happen this year, we'll see. So that debt might become more expensive on top of it. My feeling is that we probably do have a real problem on our hands. At least two. One, who's going to pay back this debt if the students can't do it? So one of the things that the students do, some of these young people do, and don't do this Academy of Finance, they go to school, they take on the debt, they never get their degree. That's not a good formula. Also, the student debt is handed out or given out irrespective of what your major might be. Now, if you're a petroleum engineer, I know you're going to have a good job. 3 years running, petroleum engineers have earned the most on average upon graduation. And there's a lot of demand for petroleum engineers in America now, you can imagine. There's some other majors where not as much demand, at least not as much compensation, even if there is that demand. But the student loans are allocated irrespective of those choices. So we have a problem on the one hand. Who's going to pay back these loans? My guess is, it's always on the taxpayer. That's one. The second thing is, if student lending becomes more constrained, more expensive, who does that hurt the most? My guess is small private colleges who lack, or which lack, large reputational footprints. Why would I spend $40,000 a year on tuition? I'm not thinking of any particular college. But why would I spend $40,000 a year on tuition when almost no one outside of this state or that state has heard of the school? Why would I send my kid to UMBC where the tuition is less? Now everyone's heard of UMBC, or either it's Maryland College Park, or St. Mary's College, or whatever it happens to be. You see my point? More people opting for public as opposed to private. That leaves the private, very expensive schools, small, not much economies of scale, and often not much in endowment either. That leaves them vulnerable financially. That's one thing to watch for. You might see a significant amount of mergers in that space. That would be my guess going forward. Yes, sir.
I know it's very speculative, but when do you see interest rates or a situation with a federal debt? When do you see some of those chickens going home to roost? And when is that potentially going to happen?
Right. The question is, with respect to the federal debt, when will the chickens come home to roost? Meaning, when will the crisis emerge? The crisis will take what form? Rising interest rates, rapidly rising interest rates. Where the bond market says we don't trust you anymore, the U.S. federal government. We know you control your printing presses, so you won't default. But you might have to print so much money to pay this debt back, the money won't be worth as much. And we don't want to be paid back in that cheaper money. So we're not going to lend to you in the first place, unless you give us higher interest rates. That's the way the crisis will look. And your question is when? Not anytime soon. Not anytime soon, I would think. I could be wrong about this. When you look at people who have a lot of skin in the game, for instance, certain major hedge fund managers who make bets like this, 5 years is what they think. If we continue to behave this way for another 5 years, we might have a problem on our hands. 5 years. It could be more like 10, 15, because look at the Japanese. People still lend to the Japanese government. They do. And often, lend to the Japanese government is viewed as a safe haven, even though their debt to GDP ratio is 250%, ours is 106%. So we might have some more room here. We might have a few more years here. I think it's irresponsible, though, because even if there isn't a crisis, you still have to raise taxes sometime in the future. Right? You still have to cut spending. In either case, it's going to fall on a future generation. So at a minimum, it's irresponsible. At a maximum, it'll induce the next crisis. And this crisis will be much bigger than the subprime mortgage crisis of 2008-2009. Because the subprime mortgage crisis of 2008, 2009, the federal government could create a stimulus package of $787 billion. The Treasury Department could issue capital to the banks. If the problem is we've already spent too much money, no stimulus package, no TARP, not necessarily at least, big problems. So we want to avoid that, we want to preempt that. And I think there's time to do that. Our economy is large enough and dynamic enough to do that. We need to do it probably within the next 5 years. Start making progress. Yes, sir?
How much does immigration affect, for you, the employment? And is that a positive or negative thing for the economy?
How does, the question is, how does immigration skew employment or unemployment? And it's not a clean answer in this case. So one, it's not even been clear to me that the illegal immigrant population is really capturing unemployment at all. Why? How do we calculate unemployment? Based on a survey. How is that survey conducted? By phone. That survey is conducted by phone. So when the federal government comes to call in, and I'm a legal immigrant, and I hear, hello, U.S. federal government here, I'd like to know, are you working, are you, click. And that's assuming I have a landline in the first place. Which I don't. So, you put that together, I don't think the illegal immigration really factors in that much, except for the following point. Even if they're not measured directly, to the extent that illegal immigrants push legal Americans out of jobs, out of construction, out of agriculture, out of other restaurants, whatever, hotels, then that shows up as unemployment, obviously. Now, in terms of legal immigration, I think by and large, legal immigration reduces unemployment. Why? Because legal immigrants have such an elevated tendency to start new businesses. So for instance, 1 in 4 Silicon Valley businesses is started by someone of Indian descent. So what do we need? More Indians. Right? That's basically the central thesis of this year's presentation. Therefore, no surprise, favor legal immigration over illegal immigration. A lot of controversy about this, a lot of emotion about this. But, and that's one of the horrible things about this Boston Marathon thing. You may not remember the name of Kazi Nafis, but Kazi Nafis was the Bangladeshi national who tried to blow up the New York Federal Reserve Bank. And when people of immigrants, and in one case, who became a U.S. citizen, do these kinds of things, it makes immigration policy more complicated than it needs to be, ought to be. It's been challenging for the Americans post 9/11 to think about what legal immigration should look like in this country. And we haven't gotten this policy right. There is some momentum, apparently on Capitol Hill, Gang of Eight, so on and so forth, to have real immigration reform. They have gotten there yet, but this is one of the things I think you'll see over the next 2 years. Maybe one more question? One more? Right, here we go.
I want to go back to the indicators that talk about our growth being 2% and get your thoughts on how QE3 is affecting that. I think we're pumping $20 billion a month into the economy, which I think is about 1.6% of GDP annualized. I assume that's helping push interest rates down and pushing the money into the stock market. Is that 2% real in light of the $20 billion a month from QE3?
Yeah, here's the question. The question is, look, isn't some of this, we're only growing 2%, but isn't even some of that artificial? Isn't some of that engineered? For instance, by the Federal Reserve, and it's actually not $20 billion. It's $85 billion a month. Not in terms of quantitative easing. I believe quantitative easing is $40 billion, but then there's another $45 million program, Operation Twist, or its successor. One buys collateralized mortgage-backed securities, one buys U.S. Treasuries, together $85 billion a month, over $1 trillion a year. And you're right, the effect of that is to keep interest rates artificially low. And yes, absolutely. If it were not for this monetary policy, the economy would be growing more slowly than it is now. As I said, there's four cylinders. Four cylinders. One, energy production. Okay. Two, housing. Well, the housing boom is motivated in large measure by these ultra-low mortgage rates. Refinancing boom, so on and so forth. Number three, consumer spending, including on automobiles. But of course, if I can refinance my mortgage, I have more money to spend on other items. And, of course, in the category of auto sales, interest rates really matter there too, because most people don't buy their cars with cash. They finance them, either lease or purchase. And then the stock market. Well, the stock market is rallying as well because interest rates are low. I can't put my money in bonds. I'm not getting any yield. Where can I go? Should I put my money in China, Russia, India, Brazil, Europe? No. So where can I put my money if I can't put it in the U.S. bond market or in foreign equity market? I'm going to put it in the U.S. equity market. Stock market rallies higher. So if you look at four cylinders, three of them are related directly, very much so, to the Federal Reserve's policy. Energy production probably relates to interest rates too, but not quite as directly. That tells you, why is the Federal Reserve doing what it's doing? Why has it been talking to about doing more? So on one hand, it talks about tapering, we're going to slow down our purchases, but some people are talking about, let's increase our purchases. Let's even get these interest rates even lower. And they, that's because they understand the composition of economic growth is really tilted for these low interest rates. If you didn't have them, we'd be growing much less than 2%. And that's what the Federal Reserve is doing what it's doing. And thank you very much, Jeff. Thank you.
Picture good in Carroll County. I think you can see the unemployment number. I assume the stock market is down. I haven't looked at the numbers right now. Things are good. The business climate in Carroll, I can tell you, all the board commissioners I've worked with, they're here. They want to hear if there is a problem with any policy that they can help out for to let business grow. I want to leave you, it's the right time and it's the right place for Carroll County for business to grow. Thank you very much.